Hi everyone, how are you guys doing? This is Pastor Peter again for my vlog. As you can see, I have another special guest today. His name is Pete Williams, and today we're going to be talking about Taiwan and missions and what it's like being a missionary in Taiwan. So I've known Pete for, I would say, almost 3 years now, because we've known each other, I would say, a little over 2 years ago when we did Vacation Bible School together this school.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember that.
I do remember that, yeah.
Actually, no, I remember you even before that, because 1 month before that, I was a substitute teacher at this school.
Yeah.
And then I saw you sitting, actually, right over there, like 20 feet away, and then I introduced myself. Yeah. And then that's when I got to know you.
I still remember the songs from Big Fish Bay.
Oh, yeah.
Every now and then, like in a quiet moment, they just pop into my head.
Big Fish Bay.
That's it.
Yes, yes. That was their
that was a VBS.
Funny, affectionate name for Jonah and Jonah's whale, right? Big Fish. Okay. Well, why don't we get started by just you introducing yourself? Tell us about yourself, tell us your background.
So I'm from the UK originally. I born and grew up. I became a Christian when I was at my first year of university or college. I guess I had a bit of a teenage rebellion. So although I grew up in church, my family were Christian, so they took me along to church. But I had quite a big teenage rebellion, and then I went to university to study aircraft engineering. And during my first year, I became a Christian. And I just became a Christian really because God saved me, but through the means by which God saved me was, I guess, just striking out on my own in life. I thought I'd found a way that was going to make me happy and all that kind of thing, and find significance and purpose and meaning, and, you know, all these big things. I kind of hung on a career and doing this degree, and I quite quickly realised that it wasn't going to work out, and so then I was stuck and looked at my family. I had two younger sisters who are very committed Christians. Mm. You know, CUs at their school, they were leading those, and really, really, really following Jesus. And so I looked at my family's life, thought, what have they got? They seem relatively happy, they don't seem to be wrestling with these questions in the same way that I am. Mm. And so in response to that, my sisters actually gave me a Bible. When I went off to university, they gave me a Bible, which I did not want, but I took it out of courtesy, out of politeness. And then a few months into my time at university, I kind of dug it out and started to read the Gospels, a bit about Jesus.
Oh, that's great.
I felt like he was speaking to me, and so that's when I became a Christian, because I felt like hey, this is real, I want in, I want to follow Jesus. And so
that's awesome.
And that's when I became a Christian. No, that's how I became a Christian.
Yeah, so it's kind of hard to reject a Bible from your family members, and it's kind of hard to throw it away afterwards, because you know that they might actually ask you about it. Oh, where's the Bible that I gave you?
Yeah.
Right? So you're not going to throw it, you're just going to leave it there, but it'll just collect dust and dirt.
Yeah.
But you actually started reading it after a while, and so that relates to you wondering about your future in terms of engineering, aircraft engineering and whatnot. Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah, I think I was just looking for purpose. So I'd had a gap year, and during that gap year, I'd had a kind of longer term relationship for an 18-year-old, like a year or so, and that broken down. And I'd done a lot of partying, but I'd seen my friends kind of end up in hospital and get kind of really like mentally, quite emotionally, quite hurt by that. So I kind of explored these different paths through my teenage years and hadn't found kind of satisfaction or purpose in those things. And so I thought that going to university to be an aircraft engineer was going to provide, if not all, a lot of that. But then I saw my university professors and other students, just lived the life for a little bit and realised, hey, look, you know, I've changed everything else, but I've still not solved that issue. I've still not found the thing. Kind of inside, I guess, I was still the same, dealing with those same questions. So that's when I've run out of ideas now. Like, I need to look somewhere else.
You exhausted all the other philosophies.
Yes. Yeah. Although I wasn't consciously ticking off philosophies.
Right.
You know, I wasn't.
Yeah, experientially. Yeah.
But yeah, in practice,
probably
was.
Well, aircraft engineering. That sounds so cool. I mean, Top Gun just came out, right? Maverick. And then, so whenever people think about aircraft engineering, they think jet fighter planes and stuff. But I'm sure there's a large mundane part of it. You're the grease monkeying, working, you
yes,
know, and,
yeah,
and all of the charts
well, yeah.
and mathematics and design and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
But then you went into missions, right? Here in Taiwan, right?
Yeah.
So how did you want to be a missionary and you saw aircraft engineering as like a path to get there? Or was it aircraft engineering, you became a Christian, and then you just changed your career entirely? Like
How did that work out?
A missionary from aircraft engineering?
So,
because you know, usually you go to seminary, right? And then, but then you didn't. You went to get an engineering degree. Right?
Yeah. So, I already started my engineering degree when I became a Christian. So, I was already on that track, and most natural thing was for me to continue that. So I kind of just continued that. But during that time, I was kind of baptized and mentored by a guy in my church who I just thought was an interesting guy, really. I thought, oh, he's an interesting guy. He, you know, he had a young family, maybe 10, 15 years older than me, probably 15 years older than me. And so he bless him, he was really kind, had the time to like get alongside me, we'd meet and chat every so often, talk about the Bible, he'd help me study the Bible and just grow my faith. Anyway, it turned out he was actually a director for a missions organization called African In Our Mission. And so just as getting to know him, as part of getting to know him, then I kind of heard about some of his stories of when he lived in Africa, church planting and these kind of things. So that, I think that really, yeah, I really enjoyed hearing those stories and that caught my imagination. I was also aware that being an aircraft engineer like opened the door for a lot of travel. So after I finished university, I then went and worked as an aircraft engineer for a couple of years, and I got opportunity to travel. And I think one of the things I really appreciate about this guy who mentored me was that he was very good at showing that kind of we're all missionaries, really. If you're a Christian, you're a missionary. You're sent. You know, Jesus says, "As the Father sent me, so I send you." And so sometimes I think it's a little bit unhelpful, or in my experience, maybe this is just my own baggage, but it can be a little unhelpful to use the word missionary to think in terms of that, because it seems like there are certain people who are sent to do this special work of being a missionary, and then everyone else is kind of just getting on with life. I don't think that's true. I think we're all called to be missionaries, and we're all, God sent us very specifically to wherever we are, and so for me, that gives me a huge amount of faith about whatever season I'm in life, God's placed me here for a reason, and so it's a case of like, okay, what have you got me here for, and you know, what do you want me to do, and searching His purpose in that.
Nice.
And so yeah, so I think I lived like that as an aircraft engineer, and I was travelling around Europe because I was working for an airline, and I was like a flying mechanic, so, well, not flying mechanic, but we were on call. So if there was a problem in the airline, then they'd send us out to go and fix it wherever that problem happened. So I went to work with my passport and got to meet a lot of people from a lot of different countries and stuff like that. I really enjoyed it. And after about 2 years in, I felt God poke me and say, I guess call me, you could put it like that, but it wasn't a big heavy call. It was more of a like, just a sort of like, you know, you've been interested in this, like you've kind of got my permission to explore it. So. I had been interested in missions, like I said, I heard about it when I first became a Christian from this guy, and so the most natural thing for me to do was to explore it, seemed like to go and try and join an organisation and use my aircraft maintenance skills to help that mission organisation.
Yeah.
So African In That Mission also have, it's called AIM Air, which is like an air department, so they use aircraft to like resource their mission in East Africa. And so I just went and volunteered, like I saved up enough money to go, went and volunteered for a year, lived in Nairobi, and I helped out in the hangar fixing aeroplanes, and also got to go on some of the trips as well, which was great. Got to experience loads, like in local church, went to a Kenyan church where I was the only white guy for most of it, which is great fun.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
You know, you learn how to dance in those kind of
really?
Churches.
Really? Nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
I really enjoyed it. And got to know the Kenyan guys that I was working with, got to see some of the mission stuff that both the church that I was going to and AIM were doing. So I really enjoyed that. And I came back from that year with a real sense of like, yeah, okay, this is something that God's got for me. And I want to pursue it further. And I also felt like maybe aircraft engineering wasn't for me, or at least wasn't the main thing. It was a useful tool, a useful resource, a useful skill, but maybe it wasn't kind of the main thing. I'd really, really seen like what the missionaries on the ground got to do, or the guys on the ground who were sharing the gospel and building the church and all that kind of stuff. And I really wanted to be involved in that one. And alongside that, the church that I had been part of in the UK, they actually asked me, hey, would you come back and help us to start up this? There was something, a youth project, like an outreach youth project centered around a youth cafe in the town. So they said, would you come back and help us start this? So that sense of like, maybe aircraft engineering isn't for me.
Yeah, yeah.
And also this opportunity that came up, just coupled together. So I went back to the UK, this is in 2012 now, and I spent about five years or so working for the church as an evangelist. That's kind of what I did.
So you were the official church evangelist?
No. Well, I struggle.
Evangelist Pete Williams?
No.
Or that was one of your roles. Like, you focus on that, okay?
Along
with other people.
Yeah, my main role was, it was called evangelism coordinator or something, or outreach pastor. I struggle with different ways to explain this because it's
bishop.
Definitely not. And it also, we're all called to be witnesses.
I knew
you'd
be
ticked
by
it.
Yes.
We're all called to be witnesses. So I'm just trying to use a label that's helpful to describe what I did.
A facilitator of evangelism. A lead facilitator of evangelism.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think that's what we were trying to capture.
Like, the key word in the current evangelical spirit is facilitator. No one wants to lead, but then if you say, oh, you're not leading, you're facilitating. Then all of a sudden, oh, thank you so much. Yeah, I'll go ahead and facilitate because I'm not a leader. But in the back of every administrator's mind, they're thinking, you're a leader.
Wow, yeah. It's just, in some ways, it's just names, isn't it? But
yeah.
That's what I did until we moved out to Taiwan.
Hmm. So what that means is that you actually did have a change of career from being an aircraft engineer to the UK as a facilitator of evangelism, as a lead facilitator of evangelism, and then you felt some sort of call, right, to Taiwan. Is that what happened? Like explain, how did it end up in
Taiwan
from Kenya to UK and then to Taiwan?
Yeah, so I felt that cross-cultural mission, or being involved in kind of, cross-cultural evangelism mission, whatever you want to call it. I think I came back from Kenya with a sense of like, yeah, this is for me, but also aware that, you know, I didn't necessarily know where, and I came back to the church with this opportunity, and it seemed like a great training opportunity for me to learn more, get involved in you know, my home country, in doing some of the things that maybe God might use me to do in the future. And so I took that opportunity, and shortly after, actually, I met Miriam, who's now my wife. And so I was kind of come back from Kenya with this sense of like, yeah, I feel a mission sometime in the future. Miriam felt God speak to her very clearly when she was a teenager about China.
Mm.
And so she had studied Chinese at university. She had as part of that, she visited both China and Taiwan. And during that process, she kind of fell in love with Taiwan. And the first time she came, she met friends, and she's still in touch with them. And they're both our friends, and we're now still in touch. We're still involved in our family and stuff, very much.
I mean,
so.
In Taiwan, not
in Taiwan. Taiwan, yeah, in Taiwan. So, yeah, she didn't really make so many friends. Or she didn't, she kind of fell in love with Taiwan and just repeated, visited, so kind of built a relationship there. You know, as we're getting to know each other, there's kind of this, I'm living with a sense of like, yeah, maybe someday in the future. Whereas Miriam's like, yeah, China, or China, Taiwan, Chinese people.
Got it.
And she was involved in her church. She was a church in central London, and there's a lot of students from kind of Singapore, Hong Kong, those kind of places. So
yeah.
She was involved in the ministry there, and, you know, really enjoyed it, and obviously with her skills of speaking Chinese and stuff like that, she was a real asset, I think. So we're getting to know each other, and I remember we had one conversation about this kind of, like, where we could live, and She's kind of like, well, I think I could live in two places, the UK or Taiwan.
Nice.
Whereas I was kind of like, well, you know, anywhere in the world.
Right.
Wherever you send me, God.
Yeah.
Anyway, so we're obviously praying about this and getting to know each other. And the first thing we needed to kind of clarify on was whether we wanted to get married. And think that's it. Obviously, we decided that we did that and got married. And then we started to talk to our church leaders about that, and about missions and what the future might hold. And we had these kind of conversations. And because of Miriam's kind of clear experience to China and Taiwan, I said, well, why don't you go and visit there and see what happens?
Okay, you've never been to Taiwan before.
I've never been to Taiwan before, no. So,
right.
I mean, yeah.
Okay,
I've never been to Asia before.
Okay, you've never been in an Asian country in your engineering experience as a missionary?
No,
yet.
No. So
okay.
We just went around Europe, and then I went to Africa, so I did
okay.
a few countries
okay.
in Africa. So yeah, so April 2016, we'd been married about a year, we came and visited, and it was kind of natural because it meant that I could meet Mim's friends out here that she kept contact with, and we just got married, so it was a nice little holiday together, 2 week holiday together, and we visited Mim's friends, and we also went down the East Coast, cycled from Hualien down to Taidong, which was beautiful, it was amazing.
It is very...
And I can actually remember, like, I can still remember sitting on the train on the way back from Taidong, back to Taipei, and I was reading a book about discipleship and just sensing, like, okay, yeah.
Okay, what book?
Okay, it was cool. It's a Building a Discipleship Culture by Mike Breen.
Okay, okay.
He's an English
cool.
guy.
Yeah, he sounds like an English guy.
Yeah.
It's not like Mike Chan or Sibrovsky or something like that. Yes.
I think he lives in America now, but I'm not
of course.
Sure.
I'm not surprised at that at all.
Just read the book.
Being an American, everyone wants to go to America. It's New Jerusalem. Anyways, come on.
So, yeah, I just felt the sense of like, yeah, okay, Taiwan. So I, obviously we went back and talked to church leaders and, you know, kind of people that knew as well and like, what do you think? And they're like, just kind of like, yeah, go for it.
Wow.
It took us about a year because we had, you know, I was working in ministry, Mim was a teacher. We had to kind of, took us about a year to transition out.
Of course.
And during that time, like, we obviously came across some challenges trying to move to the side of the world. But we also received some real confirmation from God along the way. So I come from quite a charismatic background, so open to gifts of the Spirit.
Yeah.
Lots of opportunities for praying for people and that kind of thing. So there was one very clear moment where someone that we didn't know us at all really was praying for us and had no idea what was going on and what we were considering and actually had already committed to do really. But she was just praying for us and she had this really clear sense of like us moving a long, long way and how God was going to move us and that was really the right thing that he had for us and he was going to use that to grow us and lots and lots of stuff. And it was just, you know, as us hearing it, knowing our situation, we were just like, wow, yeah, this is
okay.
Like a real confirmation.
Yeah.
That God
the
is,
sign.
Yeah, God is calling us to move to Taiwan. So we moved in August 2017 and we'd planned to get a job, but it hadn't worked out. So we just kind of came with a 3-month visa. We had a place to live for 1 month and we didn't have jobs. But we had enough money to live here for 3 months and get a plane to get back home to the UK if it didn't work out.
If all failed.
Yes. But God continually, we've been here 5 years and God continually
just
opens up one door after another and provides and takes care and guides and stuff. So within about 2 weeks, Mim got a job working at Kweishan, which is amazing.
Cool.
I found somewhere to learn Chinese. And then with that came visas. And a couple of weeks after that, we found somewhere to live up in Danshui. And then...
Wow.
But later we've got connections to the church.
Yeah,
definitely.
You know. Oh, the church that you're a part of right now, is it affiliated with your church in the UK or is it a separate entity?
It's a separate entity.
Okay.
Separate entity. Yeah, they're not. There's no affiliation. Official affiliation.
Okay.
So.
Wow. So that's truly a step of faith. Now, did you go the traditional route where you're going around and then sending letters of support so that monthly you're getting donations? For your missions work, or is it pretty much like your own career now here, but you see yourself as a missionary wherever you go, and so you're sort of like a tent maker yourself,
yeah,
or is it both?
Yeah, Well, up until now, we've been self-supporting pretty much. Mm. I mean, we're still in touch with lots of friends and family and the church back home. So, and they do support us every now and then. You know, they send out gifts, which is, we're really grateful for. It's amazing. And that's kind of helped pay for me learning Chinese and things like that. But yeah, we're self-supporting in terms of our living costs. I think it's been really helpful. So I think it's been really helpful because it's helped us to understand a bit more about Taiwanese culture and maybe some of the pressures that the people we want to reach are going through. And just, I think it also actually brings a sense of, with our neighbours at least in our current situation, then I think it's kind of given them a little bit more trust maybe. Or if you're a missionary in the traditional sense, where you don't have your job is like full-time missionary, then I think people start to ask questions like, what are you doing? Like, where's all this time going? Like, what are you doing? And this kind of thing. And I think it just helps people to receive us, because they're like, oh, right, you're a teacher at Pei Shan. You know, they've got a box to fit that in.
Right.
Whereas
a box to fit that in, good.
Yeah, do you know what I mean?
They can categorize it.
Yeah. So I think it does help from that point of view as well.
It must be really weird for people to engage with someone who's a full-time career missionary where they don't really have a regular job, quote-unquote, non-church, secular job, like them. And then how do you explain to them, oh, well, I'm fully funded by churches back home in the UK or America or Canada or whatnot. And it's hard for them to put that in a box because they don't have anything like that here. Unless, of course, there are Buddhist monks or Taoist monks are like that, but I'm not sure about that. So, yeah, there's definitely a more relational aspect where they can understand and relate to you because, hey, you got a job just like I do.
Yeah,
right?
And it does open up opportunities to get to know more people as well.
Working
alongside Taiwanese guys.
Yes. Well, cool. Tell us then, now that you're in Taiwan, what is being a missionary in Taiwan like? What are the positives and positive stories you have? What has been effective? What has been a challenge that you didn't really expect? How has being a missionary in Taiwan been?
I think because of the way we came out with a real kind of in faith, not necessarily having a huge amount of clarity about why God was calling us out here, you know, what he was calling us out here to do. Then I think we have faced some challenges. So initially we thought, well, how are we going to support ourselves? Teaching English. So we tried teaching English, and I qualified as an English teacher in the UK before we came out, kind of in preparation. So that was like the long-term plan for supporting ourselves. And we thought also it might open up some opportunities to share the gospel as well. But I tried that for, so we had our child, so we've been here 2 years, we had our first child, Annabelle, and at that point, Miriam stopped working at Kuei Shan, and I'd been language learning full time up to that point, and I then decided, the plan was that I would go and work so Miriam could be at home with the kids. So I started teaching English, and you know, kind of found that what seemed to be the best job possible, the right job, right fit, and that kind of thing. And part of that, I said to them, look, we think this is how much we need to live off, this kind of living costs in Taiwan. Do you think I'd be able to earn that? And they were like, oh, yes.
Okay.
And I worked there for a year or just over, and I was not 1 month did I earn the figure that we'd given them.
Okay.
And God provided amazingly. Like, God's been very faithful to us. But we didn't work out at all.
Okay.
But
so they said yes, but you actually didn't get the amount that they said.
I mean, in fairness, in their defense, like, I think COVID kicked off around then. I think it was around 2020.
Mm-hmm.
So although
that's tough.
It didn't affect Taiwan hugely to begin with, especially during that year, you know, maybe it was a factor. Anyway, we felt like God was kind of, well, we were asking God, what are you doing here? What should we do? And then at the end of that year, in our eyes, pretty miraculously, because we hadn't seen it coming, God opened up a door for me to come and work here at Kuei Shan. So that's how I came to work at Kuei Shan. And actually started teaching maths and physics, which is what I'm now doing.
Okay, right.
Had not foreseen that coming, but it does. I can look back and see that that makes good use of my skills, kind of as an engineer, my training
yes.
as an engineer, and also working with people. So, you know,
yeah.
and then working for the church, working with people a lot. So, I then had to kind of do another bit of retraining. And last year I did a PGCE, which is like a teaching degree, teaching qualification certification from the UK. So I did that last year, which was a lot of work because I was working part-time. We also had a family. So that was quite stretching. But I'm really glad I did it.
Mm.
And living in the benefit of it this year. Like, able to work full-time and so my wife can be at home for our second child, which is great.
Okay, nice.
So life...
Yeah.
Your question is, well, what's it like being a missionary? Well,
yeah,
there's lots
yeah.
of things that, well, it's being a missionary in Taiwan. And the way we're doing it, I think it's very, there's lots going on. And it's very hard to find. It feels like there's never quite enough time.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's just having a young family as well. We are always trying to kind of make opportunities to kind of be with people or share the gospel or kind of do the missional stuff.
Yeah.
But alongside family life or alongside what we're already doing. So kind of trying to find as much overlap as we can with, like, okay, we're doing family life. How can we do that in a way that is kind of living missionally, living as sent people rather
mm-hmm.
than, you know, having lots of dedicated time to be like, to reach out to people,
mm.
if that makes sense.
Yeah, well, give us some examples, like whether through your wife or through yourself, how have you been relating to people and trying to share the gospel with them?
So we really felt God speak to us about where we live. So the area that we live on is Ali, it's a unique place, but there's a real great sense of community there, and lots of young families as well. So we've got
mm.
two children now, and we try and use that as much as possible. So Annabelle's school, and by our eldest daughter, she goes to school like half days. We chose her school as somewhere that was close, and we also knew there was a couple of other people from our community that we'd started to get to know a little bit that sent their children there. So that helped us because we could talk to them about what the school was like and, you know, get recommendation from them. And they were really supportive of the school. And so we thought, hey, look, this is seems like it's a good school, but also it's on our estate. There's lots of other families that go there, so there's lots of opportunity to build relationships. So
mm.
that's been a great way to get to know people. And now Annabelle has friends, and her friends, it's easy for us to get to know the parents, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
There's several families that we've got to know that way and invite along to church or share our stories with. But it brings about lots of opportunities for us to kind of just, yeah, get to know people, share our stories, share the gospel, and look for those kind of God opportunities.
That's great. That sounds very much like just family lifestyle evangelism.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah, relational
yeah.
evangelism.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what have you found to be their receptivity to the gospel? Like, are Taiwanese in general, at least from your experience, pretty receptive, or are they very strict and sort of even against the gospel message? Like, what have you found to be their attitude with the gospel when you share it with them?
Yeah, I mean, I can only talk from my experience. I'd say it's mixed. I think, like, in the UK, it's probably mixed. I think comparing to the UK is probably my easiest way in, because those are the two places I've got experience
yeah.
of. So, I think in the UK, it's harder to build the initial relationship.
Mm.
And I think in Taiwan, people are often very open to building relationship. Or at least the culture is much more kind of warm and
mm-hmm.
friendly. Everybody's out and about, you just chat to people, and that's kind of what you do in the UK. You don't do that
okay.
that much anyway. So I think that element of getting to know people is great, and it's really quite easy. And I think as part of getting to know people, then you can kind of, there's opportunities to share stories about your life, either what God's done, or, you know, you just get to, as you get to know people, you can kind of share bits about yourself in that way. But I think getting to know people deeper, so more kind of like potential discipleship, is not we found that harder.
Okay.
I think in the UK, once you're, if you build those kind of relationships, then it's harder to build those relationships, but then once they're established, often it's easier to go deeper. And I think
interesting.
In Taiwan, it's probably the other way around. I think people like to hang out in that public area where it's
right.
You know, friendly, but not as deep. And so
I
think going deeper into kind of maybe more of an ongoing discipleship.
So what you're saying is that in the UK, it's harder to break the ice, but then once that's broken, you can easily get more intentional discipleship and evangelism done.
Well, it just
whereas
opens up to deeper
here.
Conversations, yeah.
Okay, yeah. And over here, it's easier to be friendly at first. You don't really have to break the ice because they want to talk.
Yeah.
But if you want to get more personal and talk about God in a more deep way, they might shy away from that. Okay. Why do you suppose that is? Is it a cultural thing, or is it just the fact that they're not Christian and they're not ready to talk about that? Or what do you think it is?
I think it's partly a cultural thing. I think it is partly a cultural thing, because I think in the UK you get that dynamic of both Christian and non-Christian. I think my experience has been the same, actually. I think both in church and outside of church.
Okay. Because I was just thinking, maybe in the UK, although the Christian population has decreased dramatically, that there still is sort of like this underlying Christian culture there. Whereas over here, it's more Buddhist and Taoist. So maybe that has something to do with it, or maybe not. I just wanted to explore that. Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah. Well, I was going to ask what methods of missions work best, but it sounds like you've answered that question, right? Is you found that the salesperson tactic doesn't seem to be the way to work it. It's more of the relational family tactic.
I mean, I'm not necessarily been particularly fruitful or effective. You know, we've not led hundreds
being
of people.
Being honest.
Not led hundreds of people.
How many, what is the 1,000th number now of the people you baptized?
Well, exactly. So I'm not really in a position to, you know, you're asking me what works best currently.
Yes.
This is what we feel like God's called us to do. And I guess that's all you can do, right?
Okay. So the relational aspect.
I think for our situation, our context, that works best. I mean, if you look at some of the churches, the larger churches here, so what, Better Life, probably the largest church here.
Yeah.
I think they would be, and they're Taiwanese guys, aren't they? So that's another dynamic. I think we're learning loads.
Mm.
So we're learning loads. So, but those guys are much. I think they're much more on the front foot with sharing the gospel. And also we've got some friends in Japan and South Korea. They have now got to the stage where they're gathering like at church equivalent on a Sunday morning, you know, 30 odd people, and I think they probably pursued a much more like an aggressive upfront kind of discipleship method of sharing the gospel early on. Well, I think we've gone a little bit slower, maybe a little bit more relational. Maybe part of that's just our life circumstance.
Right.
Part of that's our situation.
Different techniques. Yeah.
Yeah.
What would you say to Christians in Taiwan in terms of giving them some tips for evangelism? I mean, your tip would obviously, from your perspective, it would, and your experience would be definitely to build a relationship first. But would you have anything else that you would like to share from both your successes and also your failures?
I don't know if I'm giving anyone advice. My understanding of the Bible and my understanding of evangelism is that talking about Jesus is always good.
Right.
So just finding ways to talk about Jesus. That is how God has revealed himself to us, right?
Mm-hmm.
When God wanted to reveal himself clearest, he came as the person of Jesus. And so I think there's something quite profound about that. And I think we should try and adopt that in our approach to evangelism, or at least I try to do. So I think trying to talk about Jesus, and often through stories. I think stories work quite well in my experience. So sharing stories, either stories about Jesus, as in from the Bible, or sharing stories about Jesus, as in my relationship with Jesus.
Okay.
Talking quite kind of natural, down-to-earth way about Jesus in a way that reveals his character, what he's like. I think that is, for me, that's what I try and do.
Okay.
As best I can.
That's,
I think
that's,
I see that in the Bible as well.
Yeah, yeah. So stories of your own life, your own testimony,
yep.
as well as the stories of the Bible, particularly the stories of Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, for more than one person, even at the school, the non-Christian staff, at least two of them have told me that for them to become a Christian, they want to have an experience of God, like some kind of supernatural experience. And I think it's partly because the other Christian teachers, when they talk to them about the gospel, a lot of them have some sort of like a supernatural experience, a conversion experience. And so they're looking for something miraculous as well. So we can also add that to the pot, that we can pray, tell them stories of Jesus, stories of our own personal experience, but we can pray that they would also experience something genuine from God. Which I was actually surprised, because coming here, so many people, especially we're in a teaching environment, they're very academic, right? So I would think that, oh, well, maybe they've read through the different evidences for the Christian faith and believed in Christ. And of course, they know some of the evidence, but what really changed them were these stories, as well as having a personal experience. But,
yeah, I think actually, that's the other thing that I should say. I think prayer is incredibly important. I think both praying for people, like, consistently. So I try and we have a list of people in my work. We have a list of people that we're trying to reach, or we feel like God's kind of people of peace that God's put in our hearts, and so we try to pray for them every day, or as much as we can. So I think consistent prayer for them, but also looking for opportunities to pray on the spot for people. So I think I've prayed for my neighbour that I've prayed for once, and also when I was learning Chinese, one of my classmates was able to pray for. And I think if you do that in the right way, then I think it's people just feel blessed, regardless of whether they're like, you're crazy or not. They're just like, oh, well, at least the crazy person wanted to pray for
you. Yeah. Rarely will anyone deny you to pray for them if you ask them.
Yeah, but and so that's the lowest bar. That's the worst thing you're going to get. But obviously, the best thing you're going to get is this kind of experience that you're talking about.
Exactly.
Where God just breaks in and opens up. So I think.
Yeah,
prayer.
Awesome. Well, you've talked actually quite a few times about your Chinese learning. Why don't you share something in Chinese? Like, let's talk in Chinese really quick, because my Mandarin isn't that good. I think you probably would be able to defeat me.
Well, I think I'm going to talk in Chinese, but anyone who speaks Chinese watching this will be like, he's been learning Chinese. No way.
Okay, let's just do
can't be that long.
A few sentence conversations of
what would you like me to say?
Just why don't you start off with a question or something?
Yeah, 我说什么?
Can you say it again?
你要我说什么?
我要你说了，你要说的，没有关系，说了，你要说的。我也没有人是那个。我们很多的事情，就是给我们很多的福，很多书，还有就是教过我们，好好的教过我们。是。哇，你的故事很棒。
谢谢。感谢主。
Awesome. See, his Mandarin is much better than mine. I can't even say, I would say, I'll be able to say about 60% of what he just said. So that's really good. Your training is not yet complete, but it is progressing well. I wanted to ask about what I see a lot here in Taiwan is there is no doubt that Presbyterians, as well as the Mennonites, have done a great work in terms of social justice and also compassion ministries. A lot of the hospitals are named after the Mennonites. I come from Hualien, so the Mennonite hospitals are very, very strong over there. It rivals even the Buddhist Zhuji Hospital. the Presbyterian hospitals all around, the McKay, George McKay hospitals, right? And then all of the different Christian organizations are doing different, like, compassion ministries to help the poor, help the sick, the disabled, the mentally handicapped, right? The Aboriginals. Do you think that that has been effective in sharing the gospel, or does it just remain that way, where the people just are glad and accept that, but then they don't see that connection with Jesus Christ? They don't see that connection with, well, there's a reason for that. It's because God came to save us. And in the end, the physical rescue should move towards a spiritual rescue.
Well, I can't really speak about other organizations. I don't know enough about I don't know enough about what's happened. I guess it's an interesting question. Like, why do we do this kind of mercy ministries, social justice and compassion? I think I think there's a strong we just do it anyway because it's what God called us to do. It's a good reflection of God's merciful nature. Jesus talks about loving your neighbour, power of the Good Samaritan, and so I think there's value in doing it regardless of whether people realise that God, who, you know, we get to share the gospel. I think there's still value in doing it because it's what God's called us to, Jesus commanded us to do. But obviously we do want to meet people's immediate needs and their eternal needs.
Yeah.
And so you want to have that opportunity. I think in Taiwan it's culturally, it's interesting, there's a culture of reciprocity, I think. So what I mean by that is, like, if I give something, then there seems to be a natural reaction to give back. That's what should happen, and there's that kind of desire for that mutual balance, if you like, in the relationship.
Right.
And so I think I wonder is probably a better way of putting it. I wonder if there can be a, you know, if you're giving, constantly giving, and it's all one way, does that create a pressure in someone to respond? I just wonder if that's what can happen and how helpful that might be if you're wanting to share the gospel with that person. And I think
you're saying that it might backfire because they might feel like they need to become Christians even though they don't want to, because all of them, the compassion that they've been given,
they feel
so
like
they have like false conversions.
Yeah, I feel like they owe something back. Like, you've done this to me, I need to do something to come back. It's like, okay, well, you just become a Christian then. And that person's not becoming a Christian because they've
That's
had
right.
genuine faith in Jesus.
That's
they're
right.
doing it. Okay.
I invested so much in you through my compassion. Now hurry up and become a Christian.
Yeah, this person's doing it because they're like, oh, they've given some stuff to me, I need to repay them somehow.
Yeah.
I don't know, I'm still thinking about that. I think also the what did I say? It's gone. There's another dynamic which I may remember that I was thinking about.
Well,
yeah.
If it comes up, please say it. Yeah. I always wonder about that question as well, because in my denominational background, being Baptist, it's all about the verbal gospel, sharing the gospel, and the social justice and the compassion ministry part is secondary. It's definitely there. Okay, we do a lot of that, but if it doesn't end up in the verbal proclamation of the gospel, where we can save souls through the gospel, then we would rather not do it because we feel like we're sort of wasting our time, you know? Because if at the end they're just saved physically, they're still going to be wanting physically later. Right. So that's always been. But then, you know, the tension is, but a lot of times a culture in Taiwan, they may not even want to hear what you have to say until they know why it's good. Right. How do you show why it's good? Well, you show it because of the love in very physical ways, the love that Christianity can give alongside the verbal gospel. Right. To make sense of it. So I think that's always the tension.
That was the other thing I was saying. So I think along the lines of what you're saying, it can really open up opportunity to build relationship and build trust. So done in the right way, I think it definitely can build trust. I think people can, particularly if they understand that you are doing it without any expectation of repayment. Obviously, you can kind of do mass ministry in a way that communicates that. And I think then it can build trust and lay a great foundation to open up conversations about faith. But I think people can sense if you're trying to do it kind of, I'm giving you this bit of bread just because I want to talk to you about Jesus. And
true,
you know, there's that kind of,
yeah,
I think people could pick up on it. I do, intuitively. I don't know why.
Yeah, it's almost like you're giving them a bread and saying, I want you to believe in Jesus.
Yes,
I want you to believe. You can have the bread for free, you can still have the bread, but let me lay the guilt trip of the gospel.
Yeah.
I mean, it shouldn't be a guilt trip.
So I do think it's important to just genuinely be with it, go with an attitude, but I'm just going to give and do this with no expectation of anything in return.
Yeah, there's a point to be made about that as well.
Yeah.
Okay, I do have a last question, because I know that our time is limited, but I wanted you, if there was a potential missionary who's looking to do missions either as a career or as maybe they're doing something else but wants to be missional and they're thinking of going to an Asian country or whatever country, why should they come to Taiwan? Like, can you make a pitch to that potential missionary to come to Taiwan instead of other countries? Not saying the other countries are bad, but why Taiwan?
Yeah.
In your opinion, why should they go to Taiwan?
Well, there's lots of good things about Taiwan, right? Taiwan is, so I think the people are really friendly. I think one of the things that we really appreciate about living here with a young family is the community aspect. So I think where we live, like I said, it's a really, I think it's a uniquely special type of community, but there's a real great sense of community. So my two-year-old daughter has loads of people to play with, and she's growing up, but it's not just people her age, she's known by the grandmas in the community to sit downstairs and chat.
Amas.
The amas,
yeah.
So she's known by them and also their parents, and people are very willing to help out. Like, we just had our second child, they're really happy to just help out and pitch in, and so there is a richness of community life here, which we just, I don't think, it'd be hard to see how we'd get that in other countries, particularly in the West. And Taiwan also has lots of lovely food, like the mountains. I love the mountains.
Yes,
love
food and scenery.
The mountains, beautiful. Like where you live in Hualien, like that.
Yep.
East Coast bits, so amazingly beautiful. And I think so. Taiwan's got lots of great things going for it. But I think ultimately you can only go where God sends you. Like, I think that's got
to
be
to Taiwan, right? So
yeah. Well, if God is sending you to Taiwan, then go and explore, you know, go for it. But I think it's got to come from a sense of calling as well. I think you've got to feel.
True.
You've got to feel like you're doing this because this is what God wants you to do. And I think that's also very important. But Taiwan is also a very nice place to live.
Yeah.
And there's a richness of life that you can have there that is quite unique.
Yeah. From my experience, it looks like everyone here in Taiwan, whether you're in the north part, we're here in Taipei area, or in the south part, all the way down to Pingdong, Kanding, there is a respect for the Christian church. But so many people are still lost. So many people are still not Christian. So I would say that's another reason why you should come. If you want, if you're from a first world country, a developed country, and you want to go to another developed country where there's a lot of people who are not saved yet, are not Christians yet, but they respect Christians, Taiwan is the place to go. The only downside is, I don't know where the listener is coming from, the viewer is coming from, but it's always so hot here.
Yeah.
And even if it's not hot, it's humid. Like today, it's actually cold, but it's still humid. You're still sweating a little. That's
very,
like the base environment is always jungle humidity, whether cold or hot. So
but that's why the mountains are even better, because you can drive into the mountains, it's like 5-10 degrees cooler, less humid.
Right.
Unless it's raining, which
But I mean, if you're a missionary, like, this is the stuff that you want, right? You like this stuff. This is like the ruggedness that you have to go through to try to share the gospel with people. All right, I'd like to conclude my interviews with last thoughts, so you can say whatever you want. You have up to 2 minutes to say whatever you want as missionary Pete Williams. Go ahead and do your last thoughts. You have up to 2 minutes. Say whatever you want to whoever is listening. Go for it.
Is it supposed to be fun, or is it supposed to be like deep and profound?
It's up to you, but it should relate to Taiwan and missions. Yeah. Unless you don't want to, it's up to you.
I guess the one thing that would be good to talk about that I thought about as I was thinking about this, which we haven't talked about, is the importance of kind of that Philippians 2 passage about Jesus Christ, who kind of emptied himself and took on the very nature of a servant. And I think there is something really profound about that, and I think my experience of moving to Taiwan and kind of trying to live out God's calling here has I'm still learning loads about it, but it has taught me a lot about that verse. And I've had so many opportunities to try and become more like Jesus in that sense, by just taking on the nature of a servant, always trying to learn, always trying to like learn from people around me, serve people around me, and say, Father, not my will, but your will. Things taking longer, things not working out quite how I planned or anything like that, but still trusting that, learning to trust and be hopeful in those situations, knowing that God is working but that I can't see it. And I think that is, I don't know how long I'll stay in Taiwan for, but I think that's the thing that I most value at the moment about moving to Taiwan, because it brings a deeper sense of peace, which brings a deeper sense of joy.
Wow.
And more resilience. Yeah, there you go. I wasn't
awesome.
Found.
You
I'm
went
that,
deep.
I'm not that funny.
You went deep.
Don't have that.
Hey, but you laugh at all my jokes. So is that courtesy or is it genuine laughter? You know, or
no, that's genuine laughter.
Maybe my jokes was too corny, and so you laugh at how ridiculously silly it is. But all right, thank you so much, Pete, for joining me in this interview, and hope all of you that are watching have benefited from it. And I guess until next time, I'll talk to you all. We will talk to you all later.
Bye-bye. Bye.